I have recently written a new book. It's called Real Fake in English and Echt Nep in Dutch. And we started writing the book about 2.5 years ago, when basically the corona pandemic started to exist and changed the whole world. And when we started writing the book, immediately we experienced the idea that we have been catapulted into the future. What we planned for 2030 already happened in 2020. And one of the strangest things that happened was the screenification of our world. We have been experiencing the real world behind our screens. And I have had, I think, Microsoft Teams on my laptop for several years now. I never used it. And nowadays it's still the most important application on my laptop. I heard your CEO talk about we are going to build a better society by building a better internet. And I completely agree with that idea. But before we are entering a better society, we still have to look at what happened in the recent past. Some bad stuff as well. And technology has this law. Technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. It totally depends on how people are using the internet. And I think for the last couple of years, we have seen some really strange things. And it all started with this nice guy on top, Donald Trump. I think he introduced us to fake news.
This was the largest audience to ever witness an inauguration, period.
Sean Spicer, our press secretary, gave alternative facts to that.
But truth isn't truth.
What you're seeing and what you're reading is not what's happening.
At one point, you mentioned in a debate that there are no-go zones in the Netherlands and that cars and politicians are being set on fire in the Netherlands.
I didn't say that. That is actually an incorrect statement. Yeah, we would call it fake news.
Is that
I
fake
never
news?
Said that.
Because it's what but you actually said.
No, it's not what I said.
The Islamic movement has now gotten to a point where they have put Europe into chaos. Chaos in the Netherlands, there are cars being burned, there are politicians that are being burned, and yes, there are no-go zones in the Netherlands.
You call it fake news, obviously.
I didn't call that fake news. I didn't use the word this today.
No?
No.
Totally flabbergasted, but that's the normal way we communicate nowadays in our society. And the normal way, we now even have technologies to create all kinds of deepfakes.
President Trump is a total and complete dipshit.
Well, Obama never has said it, but now you can just copy and paste the face and the words on somebody else's body. And even these strange kind of conspiracy theories, the flat earth theory, Pizzagate, QAnon, and I'm a strong believer of the movement real birds don't exist anymore. They've all been replaced by drones, so I'm I really like to support that. But nowadays we don't even know what's reality anymore, and I think that's an important thing to know. For example, look at the war in Ukraine.
Украина в ваших новостях и Украина в реальной жизни это две совершенно разные страны. И главное их отличие в том, что наше настоящее.
And if you start thinking about this, and it's basically the subtitle of our book, we are entering an era, the next 10 years, we are going to play with reality by using AI, by using deepfake technologies, and by even entering the metaverse. And to understand it, I think it's really important to look through the eyes of the youngest generation. They have been growing up with the internet. They've been growing up with smartphones. So how are they looking at the world? Because they will enter our workforce within a couple of next years. So what are they doing? These girls, they've paid quite a lot of money to be at the baseball game. And well, as you have noticed, they don't watch the game at all. They're just watching themselves. Maybe it's funny or not, but even we are doing it nowadays. 15 years ago, nobody had a smartphone, And if you now look at how we experience the game, the golf game by Tiger Woods, everybody is watching at Tiger Woods through his screen. We have become a spectator of our own experience. Is it bad or good? Strange things are happening. Nowadays, you see all these kinds of challenges on the internet. For example, the Kiki Challenge, a number by Drake, and people are making a funny dance on this number by stepping out of a driving car. KB, do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me, 'cause I want you. And I need key, do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me, 'cause I want you. 'Cause I want you. And I need you. And I'm down for you always, KB. Do you love me? Are you riding? Say you never ever leave from beside me, 'cause I want you. Kiki, do you love me? Are you riding? The guy broke his wrist. The bill of the doctor was about $5,000, but he earned $50,000 by putting it on YouTube. So this is the new way of work for this new generation. But you start asking yourself, is this new generation really smart or really dumb?
Look at this and tell me what time it is.
Oh, no. No, I can't. It is 4:37. Is that correct? It's 2. I want to say 40. No, not 45.
Chris, let me ask you this. Where do you go to college?
UC Arlington.
You want to say anything to your teachers back in college?
Not at all, because they're going to be so disappointed that I have not read a clock like this since elementary school. Let me see. Okay.
Oh, man. It is 8:10? 8:20? 8:17. No?
AM or PM?
And again, we are laughing about it, but just start thinking about this generation. Do they really need to know how an analog clock works? Do they still need to read, or can they just ask simple questions to Apple Siri? So if you start looking through the eyes of this generation, how would this impact our society? And I've got a small question, I really would like everybody to stand up. So please stand up. I've got 24 icons. 24 icons of big internet companies. Icons of memes, icons of games. And I want to know how many of these icons you do know. First question, if you know not more than 12 icons, please sit down. So if you know more than 12 icons, you are allowed to stand. Okay, so this is half of the room. How many people know more than 18 icons? Okay, there's just one guy left in the room. Let me please give you my book. And what is interesting, if you look at this picture, the top two rows, they are all basically old icons. The bottom two rows, they are the newest things. This is where the newest generations are, and nobody knows them. So this gets me kind of worried, because nowadays, internet culture is the most important thing on earth. This is the way we communicate, work, organize our lives. And this new generation, they think completely different about themselves. Online is more important than offline. They feel more comfortable when they are online than when they are offline. And in my book, Real Fake, we have these two principles, and I'm going to talk about it because they are defining our future. First principle is that fake is the new real. This lady, she's standing in front of a pink wall. It's the wall of Paul Smith, a clothing shop in Hollywood. And it is the biggest attraction of Hollywood nowadays. Young people are traveling to Hollywood to get their picture taken in front of this pink wall, because their online status is more important than the physical status. If you now look nowadays on the streets, look at young girls. They all have this Nike logo on top of their brows. And they are now going to plastic surgeons to ask them, can you please make me resemble like my digital selfie?
Just last week, I had a patient come in and ask me for more of an anime eye, and she couldn't figure out why it's not possible.
An anime eye, did you say?
Yes, to have her eyes made like roughly 3 times larger than what she already had or what she currently had. And that's just one of the things. It all comes from a self-absorption. Well, you can call it an obsession sometimes. It first started, with looking at yourself in the mirror and looking at photographs, then digital photography and being able to manipulate things on applications. The selfie generation, we had a different set of adjustments that were being done, and now we have applications that can even make you look like an animal.
So your next coworker might become an animal, but the most important thing is that they can basically create anything. This girl, she's called Little Michaela. She has 3.5 million followers on Instagram. She makes her own songs. You can listen to her on Spotify. She's supported by all kinds of big clothing brands, but she doesn't exist. She's completely created by artificial intelligence. It's a CGI influencer. This girl, this Japanese girl, her alter ego is called Code Miku. She is a virtual YouTuber. That's the way she earns money, by basically selling slogans on her chest. This is the next version of her, almost basically completely realistic. And even if you start looking at the newest technology of Samsung Neons, virtual humans that can basically take on a job. So if you start looking at the future, how the internet is evolving. One of the first things that's important is the next generation. But it all used to be about, well, quite simple media, analog media, the first printing press, books, newspapers. Then we had electronic media, the radio, the television, the telephone. And the last couple of 20, 30 years, it was all about digital media, social media, LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter. And the next couple of years will be all about synthetic media, user-generated content by using AI.
Synthetic media is a catch-all term for media, such as images, sound, text, video, and virtual experiences, or a combination of synthesized pieces of information that is either manipulated or wholly generated by artificial intelligence.
By using generative adversarial networks, GANs, machines can become creative, and we people can use them. And at the beginning of the corona pandemic, I started using these artificial intelligence to basically promote myself within my Zoom meetings. Small movie is in Dutch, but it's subtitled in English.
Ik wil jullie iets laten zien. Hoe makkelijk het tegenwoordig is om onze realiteit te bewerken. Om met de werkelijkheid te spelen. We kunnen inmiddels allemaal onze achtergrond veranderen in onze videovergadering. Maar het gaat me niet om die achtergrond. Het gaat mij juist om die voorgrond. Hoe makkelijk is het om deze te veranderen? Dan kan ik mijzelf verouderen, verjongen of van geslacht veranderen. Met filters zie je eruit als een kat of als een varken. Ik kan mijzelf als een CGI-influencer voordoen, zoals een Little Michaela of als een emoji. Ik kan gebruik maken van een animatie die reageert op mijn stem, op mijn bewegingen en ook nog eens kan zwaaien naar het publiek. Daag! Je kunt je voordoen als een beroemdheid of een deep nude. Al deze bewegingen van onze realiteit roepen bij mij vragen op. Wat is nog echt? Wat niet? Wat is feit of fictie? Wie kan ik nog vertrouwen? Het antwoord op al deze vragen heb ik niet. Het zet me wel aan het denken.
Playing with reality. And I'm not a coder. I'm no guru. I'm no nerd. But it took me one day to create this movie 2 years ago. Nowadays I could create the same kind of movie, I think, within an hour. And basically everybody can do it. Because we now have Hollywood at home. And This is a major moment in history. The moment that Will Smith slapped, well, the other guy. Yeah, Chris Rock, thank you. But the funny thing is that it immediately exploded on the internet and people started recreating this moment.
Uh-oh, Richard!
A virtual reality experience just created at home by somebody within 5 minutes. Think about TikTok. It's bigger than YouTube. And 30 seconds, 3 minutes of these kind of movies about silly dances, but also about different kinds of education. This is completely changing the way we are communicating with each other. This girl, she's called Kat Norton. She's about 25 years old, and basically every day she makes a small movie, about 30 seconds long, where she explains a certain functionality within Excel. She's called Miss Excel nowadays. She started 1.5 years ago. Nowadays she has 20 people working for her, and she earns about $5 million a month by just using TikTok, by using the filters, the CGI, the artificial intelligence behind TikTok. And everybody can do it. Because internet is changing again. Web 1.0, it was all about reading information. It was about clicking on web pages. Web 2.0, it was about basically having a voice on the internet. You could react by using social media. And the next phase will be about owning the internet. That you can own a certain piece of the internet. And again, I've made this small picture to explain it even more. Is not only the idea that fake is a new real. No, the second principle is that fake has become more important, more worth than the real thing. This Gucci bag, you can buy it in Roblox. There's only one bag, and one avatar bought it for $2,400. So one avatar within the environment of Roblox can wear this Gucci bag. The same kind of bag you can buy in the Netherlands or in any shop of Gucci worldwide for $1,400. So fake has become worth more than the real thing. And that is a strange thing that we are not accustomed to. But my children, they live in the world of Fortnite. They live in the world of Roblox. They live in the world of Minecraft. They have been buying stuff on the internet to dress themselves, their avatars. So the whole world of NFTs, non-fungible tokens. And people are laughing about it. It's a hype, it's a bubble. But the whole idea about non-fungible tokens is that we can basically now copy anything of the physical world into the digital world. So we have a new complete economy starting to rise up. This is the painting of the artwork by Beeple. His collection of 5,000 images he created over the last couple of years. Digital art, it has been sold for $65 million. Memes like Neon Cat or The Disaster Girl, Charlie Has Bitten My Finger. These kind of things are being sold now on the internet as well. You can own a certain meme. Collectibles, NBA Top Shots, moments in NBA, the basketball game in the United States. You can own certain movie moments. And people sell them, earn money with them. Virtual fashion. Sneakers, clothing, digital clothing to dress up your avatar, to give your online status more importance. Young people are doing it. And this might be the strangest thing. This is Zetrun. It's a virtual horse race. And every horse resembles a unique NFT. And each horse costs about $200, $300 when you first buy it. After you've bought it, you can start immediately racing with your horse. If your horse wins races, they become more important and the value of the horse goes up. Nowadays, some of these digital horses are being sold for about $500,000. The funny thing is that people are watching these virtual horse races. 70,000 people are watching every day on Twitch these virtual horse races. And now the most exciting thing, if you own a male horse and a female horse, well, you get the drift. They can have virtual sex. And you have this young horse. You can educate it, you can train it, and it can earn money for you. A complete different mindset about how the internet is changing when we can own a certain piece of the internet. Messi, he left Barcelona, he started playing for Paris Saint-Germain, and part of his contract was paid by fan tokens. His fans created their own crypto coin, and when he became the newest player of Paris Saint-Germain, the coin raised in value, and he earned a lot more. And basically, the fans of Paris Saint-Germain own now a piece of Messi. These apes, the Bored Apes Yacht Club, there are 10,000 of them. They are unique. They are PFPs, they are so-called. People are buying them for about $1.5 million. And everybody can copy these apes. Copy and paste an ape. The funny thing is, it's an NFT, so one person on this earth owns this certificate of this digital property. And he can sell it, transfer it, own it. And these images are now being used to create new kinds of Hollywood movies. And all the owners of the apes earn a piece of the income. They are even creating this new virtual world with their own coin. And I think that's exciting, because this shows where the internet is going for the next 10 years. It's all about the metaverse. And the metaverse, companies like Microsoft, Meta, Apple are talking about it. But why is it important? Why is it the next phase of the internet? Because you can basically transport yourself into this environment. It's the embodiment of the internet. Nowadays, once a week, I have these meetings with my colleagues in the working space of Meta. So I put on my glasses, I'm sitting behind my desk, and then my colleagues join me in my virtual room. And I have the feeling that they are sitting next to me. I can hear them in my left and my right ear. I can even touch them. So the new internet is not about web pages anymore. It's about places where you can travel, where you can go to. Nike has Nikeland within Roblox. 7 million people are visiting Nikeland every day to play games, but also to buy Nike clothing. And the really big idea behind it, if you are joining these spaces, you become part of the environment as well. Young flame here, sicko mode. Make this here with all the ice on in the... So we are becoming content ourselves. And this is Travis Scott, the rapper. He couldn't perform during Corona, so he performed in Fortnite for 21 million people. And this is my avatar in front. And even if I now look at this movie, I still have certain feelings about it. I still have these digital memories within my head. So we are becoming the story of these new kinds of worlds. And it might be strange. Young people are doing it, but also the old people are now starting to think about it. ABBA, 70 years old. They released their latest CD last year, Voyage, but they are too old to perform. So they've created these holograms of themselves, the so-called avatars, and they are starting to perform in a physical concert hall. And it's going to be spectacular.
There is something irresistible in this, being able to replicate yourself in zeros and ones and on huge screens with 3,000 people in the audience. It's going to be something spectacular.
And last week it started. I'm going to show a real small movie about how it looks in real life. And you see the people in the audience, they are dancing, they are interacting with this new digital environment, this new kind of metaverse. And also all kinds of ethical questions are starting to pop up, because the singers of ABBA, they are over 70 years old, they will die, but they will earn money even when they're dead. So what about death? Is it still there in the future? There's this mother in South Korea, she has lost her child when she was 6 years old, and she has recreated her in a virtual environment.
Mama, what did you just do?
Mama,
항상 엄마 내 생각했어?
맨날 해.
아니 엄마 많이 보고 싶었어.
Most people think this is going too far. But what about this?
My God. Holy smokes. She's alive.
Yeah, it brings the picture to life.
Look at that smile. Oh, God.
Isn't it amazing that technology?
I can't believe it. Oh.
Oh.
It's her. It's kind of heartbreaking. And now companies are starting to think about these solutions as well. Salvador Dali, the famous artist, he has been dead for several years now, but he's now the guide in his own museum.
Greetings. I am Salvador Felipe Jacinto Dali y Domenech. And I am back. Before you leave, you will take a picture with me?
Sure.
Uno, dos, tres. Ooh la la!
So everybody likes taking selfies with a dead guy, so that erases all kinds of ethical questions. I've shown you now about 70 slides. If you look at the future of the internet, you have to look through the newest generation, Generation Z and Alpha, because they have been growing up in this digital environment. And they have experienced how the internet culture is basically changing, impacting everything we do in our personal lives, in our businesses, and in our society. Think about the good and the bad things, the conspiracy theories, but also deepfake technology that might be used for therapy or something. They have two principles. Fake is the new real, and fake is worth more than real. And if you start to realize these principles, if you really start to think about it, it introduces us to the last phase of the internet.
Sometimes people draw this juxtaposition of there's like the digital world and the real world. That's not actually how I think about it. I think that there's a physical world and a digital world, and the real world is actually both.
The real world is actually both. The newest generation doesn't think about digital and physical anymore. For them, it's all about reality. Everything is real to them.
How do we know what is real?
And what would reality mean when a world we can build feels as real as our own?
And the young girl was like, why? And I was like, what do you mean? She was like, who cares if it's real? Mm. And I was like, what, you don't care if it's real? And she was like, no.
Everything is real to them. A virtual environment, an augmented reality environment, a game like Fortnite or Roblox, even the world of Instagram, Snapchat, and TikTok, it has become the new reality. So there's just one thing left for you to do. Don't be afraid for all these new kind of technologies that's starting to pop up for the next 10 years, but start experimenting with them. Open up a TikTok account. Start playing with it. Buy an Oculus Quest. It costs about $400, $500, but experience what it means to live and work in a virtual world. So don't be afraid, start to experiment. Well, thank you. If you want to know more, I'm always online. And otherwise, read the book. Thank you.